suicide, the act of taking one's own life voluntarily and intentionally. An ugly word. We all know what it means for the body. It's the end of a life, or an earthly incarnation, if you will. But what's going on with the soul? Is the act planned in advance? Does it lead to some sort of punishment or even damnation? Or could it be a step on our growth path? That's the focus of this episode of Unlocking the Soul with Rob Simperman. You may be familiar with my documentary, Unlocking the Soul. It walks through the consensus and findings of three of the most credible modern channels, Edgar Cayce, Jane Roberts, and Paul Selig, and two regression hypnotherapy pioneers, Dolores Cannon and Dr. Michael Newton. I draw a lot of my information from those same sources today. So if you're new to spiritualism, some of my premises related to reincarnation and our activities in the spirit world between lives might blow your mind. One topic I did not delve into previously is suicide. I had a college friend and a high school friend who each committed suicide, and then just last week I learned another dear friend lost her young adult son in the same tragic way. So I felt some urgency to explain this topic from a spiritualism perspective. But I need to start out saying that if you're thinking about suicide, or are worried about a friend or loved one, or would like emotional support, the Suicide and Crisis Lifeline Network is available 24/7 across the United States by calling or texting 988. It's free and confidential. If outside the US, please find a comparable local support system. I'm not a psychologist or a therapist myself, but just a spiritual researcher and a filmmaker. That said, let's start out looking at some of the factors that drive people to suicide. And after that, we'll look at evidence about the repercussions of suicide to the soul. And finally, we'll talk about some therapies or ways to help a troubled soul. My most prolific source on this topic is the channeled work of Jane Roberts. Her 1,500 sessions channeling a disincarnate ascended soul named Seth produced the contents of 10 books dictated by Seth in their entirety, plus 12 collections of standalone sessions published as books, and 8 other books dictated in altered state of consciousness. These material include 73 passages with references to suicide. It's important to understand that souls don't come to Earth to be perfect. They come to learn lessons and experience the low-frequency Earth like a schoolhouse. Dr. Newton and Dolores Cannon found that the root cause of many seemingly evil acts is when soul influence, that is seen as the conscience, is too weak to override human impulses. This could simply be the result of underestimating the portion of a soul's energy required for a particular incarnation, or overestimating their current skill level. Remember that souls are the ultimate multitaskers. While you're here living, parts of your soul may simultaneously be living other lives, learning new skills, building worlds, or guiding others. So souls may make unwise allocation decisions, leaving them unprepared for a challenging life. Now, these souls will likely get an earful from their guide and the elders when reviewing this life. But first, damaged souls recuperate and repair energy after a hard life. They can take as long as they need in what some describe as an emerald city, where they get help from healing specialists. Seth also described an initial stage for those still focused strongly in the physical reality and in need of a period of rest. He says our guides can hallucinate a hospital or a rest home on our behalf for a break or to orient us to the situation. And they may even take a resting life after a hard one to refresh their energy, a sabbatical of sorts before proceeding on the path. But lives that are so hard that they result in suicide are just a subset of hard lives. So what are those troubled souls dealing with? People often think up preconditions for their happiness. Maybe they feel like their worthiness depends on parental acceptance, respect from their community, a happy marriage, a conventional gender identity, or the accumulation of wealth. Seth further explains, "Now, this sounds idiotic to you. There are people who have committed suicide because they established wealth as a condition of existence. They were unable to appreciate a love relationship because of this preoccupation, and you have been unwilling to appreciate the miracle of your existence because of your preoccupation." Now, coupled with logical traps, poor communications may lead to a basic misunderstanding of the situation one finds oneself in. Seth explains that, indeed, part of the would-be suicide's dilemma may be caused by a lack of communication with others, a misinterpretation of the motives of friends or family members, and a difficulty in expressing one's own needs and wishes. And finally, a personality trait that Seth points to as increasing the likelihood of suicide is, ironically, a need to feel more alive. He explains, certainly it is usually taken for granted that suicides are afraid of life. However, suicides and would-be suicides often have such a great literal lust for life that they constantly put it into jeopardy so they can experience what it is in heightened form. As humans, we innately feel drawn to cooperate with others and be helpful to people in a way that contributes to the common good. Many people who commit suicide feel, to the contrary, that they are no longer needed, or in fact that their very existence stands in the way of other people's happiness. And somewhat counterintuitively in this matter, someone's position in society doesn't correlate with their perceived self-worth. Seth says, young adult suicides are not necessarily from the poorest or the lowest strata of society at all. In fact, poverty often serves as a strong impetus, leading the individual to fight for his or her daily needs. Such a person's days may be so crowded with desperate activity that there is no time with which to even contemplate suicide, because the struggle for life itself is so intense. Sometimes a soul's feeling of uselessness is related to their specific pre-planned goals for their incarnation. The subject of A Hypnotist's Journey to the Secrets of the Sphinx by Sarah Bruskman Cosmi describes that in a former life, she was lobotomized in a mental institution in response to her sharing her past life memories with the more judgmental society of the 1970s. She knew she would never be taken seriously after that procedure, and her ability to further share her wisdom was over for that lifetime. She decided to end her abusive existence in the asylum and exited her body just in time to see it drop down from the Brooklyn Bridge into the river below. She then took a few years in a resting place to reflect and relax. She concluded that her mistake was being too impatient with revealing her information, but she understood that she would have to repeat the mission of that life, and is doing so now by sharing the same revealed knowledge more effectively in this lifetime, now that the timing is right in our more open-minded society. Seth is a big proponent of our belief systems, which are often passed down through generations or even from past lives, leading to the positive or negative emotions that bring about a physical or emotional illness. But just as the cause is internal to the soul, so is the solution. He says, it is important to note that regardless of the mental and physical illness adopted, it is chosen for a reason and is a natural method that this individual himself knows he is physically and mentally equipped to handle. He described how we can teach children in particular that instead of developing a belief system that, say, all illness has worsened without external therapy, have the child play a healing game in which he or she playfully imagines being completely healthy again outdoors and playing. Or have the youngster imagine a conversation with a friend describing the illness as past and gone. Now, it's not surprising that mind-altering drugs, whether prescribed, recreational, or illegal, should be used with the utmost caution, particularly by people in depressed states. Seth explains that under drugs, choices become limited, and certain people have committed suicide while under the influence of drugs who may not have otherwise. I'm not saying that drugs alone will cause suicide, but the psychology of drugs already includes an attitude that promotes a Russian roulette kind of mentality that can only add to the problem. Now, those who feel compelled to escape a dire health situation, called euthanasia, is a special case. Most spiritualist sources would not even group this in with suicide at all. As Dr. Newton says, I want to add that those who escape from chronic physical pain or almost total incapacity on earth by killing themselves feel no remorse as souls. Their guides and friends also have a more accepting view towards this motivation for suicide. So here's an interesting reason behind some souls choosing to exit early. Some people who have a very challenging life are from a cohort of souls who often feel like they don't belong here. They might feel like they constantly yearn for their true home, or even feel like being human is a mismatch or mistake for their soul. Dolores Cannon and others have extensive findings about the so-called three waves of volunteers. These souls come to Earth not for their own developmental goals, but to help the Earth raise its frequency for the current ascension to a higher plane. They may be from alien worlds, energy beings, or ascended souls coming back for a lifetime. However, particularly the initial wave, who would be elderly now, often resorted to suicide from the frictions in the transition to their first human incarnations. The appropriate response is to thank these souls for their selfless service to humanity. Learn more about this in Cannon's book, The Three Waves of Volunteers and the New Earth. Now, to an extent, every death is a suicide from the soul's perspective. This is because each soul chooses its exit point in advance. In most cases, death is a purely individual and personal decision. But in some cases, souls choose to partake in mass events for the good of society. Think about the societal stress over wars, the recent surge in mass shootings, or the recent pandemic. Remember that society is meant to be a rich learning environment for the souls incarnate here. As such, sometimes we need emotional stress and tough situations to react to. As Seth explains back in 1977, when polio and the Spanish flu were more recent pandemics, to a certain extent, epidemics are the result of a mass suicide phenomenon on the parts of those involved. Biological, sociological, or even economic factors may be involved, in that for a variety of reasons, and at different levels, whole groups of individuals want to die at any given time. But in such a way that the individual deaths amount to a mass statement. If that's the case, we don't have to think too hard to identify the mass statements made by those who exited during the recent COVID-19 pandemic, which was ripe with social, political, geopolitical, familial, and medical debates that stretched our logic and our emotions raw. It made it an interesting time to be alive, for sure. Next, let's talk about the repercussions of suicide on the soul. Let me make it very clear that there is a consensus among spiritualist sources that no one is damned for committing suicide. There are no particular punishments as such. In fact, our spiritual experts agree that there is no hell at all. There is no personified evil or Satan, nor is there eternal damnation. The idea that good needs to be balanced out by evil is just a rationalization for our fallibility by our logical minds. As one of Cannon's subjects tells her, "There is no good or bad souls, only evolving souls, but some have bad lives." Now, this is obvious to our higher selves, but our earthly minds get confused by ego and logic. In fact, renowned channel Paul Selig tells us that there is outrage in the higher dimensions that man created damnation for himself when there was meant to be love, and that we have slaughtered innocents on earth in the name of God, who is nothing but love made manifest. Like with anything else, the beliefs of the individual are important drivers of the repercussions one can expect. Seth refers to this as the inner reality and realization of the individual. As such, an action drenched in guilt will set the soul backwards in its progress. Seth states that many philosophies teach that suicides are met by a sort of special, almost vindictive fate, and such is not the case. However, if a person kills himself, believing that the act will annihilate his consciousness forever, then this false idea may severely impede his progress, for it will be further intensified by guilt. In addition to guilt, sadness or despair are other emotions our souls may feel after a suicide. One of Dr. Newton's subjects describes a meeting with his guide after a taxing life that ended in suicide. After being asked whether his guide was upset with him over the recent life, he responded, "No, I'm more upset with myself over what I did and didn't do, and he knows that. Advisors can be displeased, but they don't humiliate us. They are too superior for that." When asked directly whether anyone will condemn him for committing suicide, he responded, "Well, my friends won't give me any pats on the back either. I feel sadness for what I did." Newton talks about how each bodily incarnation imprints on a soul, which takes a while to dissipate after death. So a soul is bathed in an energy shower to restore it. He asks the subject if the ravages of the physical body and the human mind leave an emotional mark on the soul after death. God, yes, My very expression, who I am as a being, was affected by the brain and body I occupied. He also draws a parallel between such transition periods and the concept of purgatory, which is a transitory state of temporary banishment for sins of a minor nature, and the Tibetan Buddhist concept of the bardo, a spiritual separation between lives to absolve evil acts. And Cannon found that souls who die while addicted to drugs, alcohol, lust, or other low-energy habits are not ready to reincarnate. They spend time watching the physical world as if trying to satisfy their cravings. This is similar to the Buddhist concept of the hungry ghosts. But when ready to move on, they get the same assistance and healing that other souls do and resume their reincarnation cycle. One of Cannon's subjects makes clear that there's no concept of payback with regards to karma. Rather, a soul may want to understand the reasoning behind an act by experiencing the complementary reality, or to be on the other end of the stick. Then, it's not necessary to repeat such mistakes. We are our own judge and jury, her subject says, and thus we decide our own penance and subsequent lessons. But sometimes we need guidance to get back on the path from our guide, or elders, when our judgment gets clouded by challenging situations. See my video on karma for more information. Next, we will review some specific guidance for dealing with people who have suicidal tendencies from our spiritual sources. All would-be suicides do not follow through, and many end up leading long and productive lives, so that even when negative ideas are present in their most severe forms, there's still hope for improvement and accomplishment. For example, Seth provides guidance for when someone reaches out with suicidal impulses, saying that communication and engagement are often the keys to clearing up the confusion and isolation they may feel. Would-be suicides, for all their secrecy, usually do mention the subject to a friend, relative, or close family member. The subject should not be ignored or condemned, but honestly examined. Part of the mystique of the suicidal impulse is indeed the secretive aspect. So the very expression of the feeling is beneficial and leads to better communication. Indeed, part of the would-be suicide's dilemma may be caused by a lack of communication with others, a misinterpretation of the motives of friends or family members, and a difficulty in expressing one's own needs and wishes. We talked earlier about logic traps and living in your thoughts as a trap that can lead a person to conclude that suicide is called for, the only escape, or even inevitable. So it should come as no surprise that the opposite of overthinking is a remedy for suicidal thoughts, trusting one's own spontaneity. The will to live is also inbred into each element of nature, and if you trust your own spontaneity, then that will to be is joyfully released and expressed through all of your activities. It can also quite literally wash depression and suicidal tendencies away. And of course, a related concept to spontaneity is being present, as enabled by meditation practices that allow us to demote our thoughts to the rightful place as features of the mind rather than its dictator. Everyone from Buddha to Jesus understood meditation can play a central role in a healthy mind, body, emotional state, and soul. The inclusion of such an individual in some kind of group situation is an excellent procedure. Communication between several people, all of whom have contemplated suicide, can also set up an excellent supportive situation, particularly with some direction set by a therapist. Now, when I read about the tools that guides can employ in this next quote, I can't help thinking about the angel Clarence from It's a Wonderful Life, helping George see the world if he takes the suicide route. Seth says, "Again, teachers are available to explain the true situation. Various therapies are used. For example, the personality may be led back to the events prior to the decision. Then the personality is allowed to change the decision. An amnesia effect is induced, so that the suicide itself is forgotten. Only later is the individual informed of the act, when he is better able to face it and understand it." Now, Dolores Cannon identified another shocking intervention. She encountered a so-called walk-in situation in response to a planned suicide in her very first book, Five Lives Remembered. In this case, the woman prepared to commit suicide. She even had a large party to see her friends one last time. But after the party, the woman had a dramatic and positive personality change and never considered suicide again. Through her hypnotherapy sessions, she learned that her original soul brought too little soul energy for that lifetime. She revised her soul contract and allowed a more mature soul to overshadow her and take over the life. This is possible because not all souls enter as babies. There is an alternate path for souls who get in over their heads, so to speak, to swap bodies as adults. Such an exchange of souls is always agreed to in advance by the departing and the replacement soul, so it's still an act of free will. This is what's known as a walk-in. We can't end without consideration of the impact of suicides on loved ones left on Earth. In the book Wisdom of Souls by Michael Newton Institute, we learn of a regression hypnosis case where a woman recalls a life with decades of intense grief after her son's suicide. In her session, she was able to talk to her guide and the deceased son's soul, who explained the circumstances of death. She had a very strong bond with her two sons. After her first son's heart attack, she felt cheated and responsible for the suicide of her second son. Her second son told her that it wasn't her fault and that he exercised free will in his exit from that lifetime. He's already reincarnated on the far side of this earth with a new family and has happy children of his own. Through the session, she was able to find closure and improve her own life and mental health. While a trying experience for all involved, suicide is one of the rich tools that the universe has made available to souls granted free will, as humans have been. As such, we need to consider the role of suicide in the developmental path of the soul without judgment for those who utilized it. Here, the best quote I found to help us see the bigger picture: "My suicides and mental health problems in past lives have taught me a lot. I have good insights into others and what my clients are experiencing. I have been an abuser in past lives, but that was a long time ago. From that, I have insights into perpetrators and know they feel vulnerable and like victims inside. Everything I've experienced has taught me insight, compassion, and understanding. I can be with people and patient. I have experienced life from many different angles. All is valuable." I'll leave you with those parting words, my friends. Again, take all of these insights as tools to understand the role suicide plays in the reality of souls incarnate on Earth. But if you need additional resources, please reach out to the trained professionals on these matters. And if you haven't yet, please click the subscribe button below to show your support. It's the lifeblood of a channel like this. And share this video with anyone who could benefit, and see my other videos on unlocking the soul. Thank you.